can you just do your name, and I know you're both executive producers, but just the names so that the transcriber can match your voice to the...
I'm David Bardis.
And I'm Gene Klein.
Thank you.
So what about this project?
Yeah, that's a hard one.
What about this project excited you besides George R.R. Martin? What made you say, this is my show, I want to bring this to life?
I think it's how unique it is. I mean, obviously when a writer brings you a novella from George R.R. Martin, you're paying attention very carefully in the meeting, but Jeff brought a really unique, authentic, original vision to an already interesting piece of material, and then as we started to talk about developing it, we talked about, you know, adding a layer of honesty to all of the craziness that we try to bring to everything that we do. But it was really just how unique the vision for the show.
Well, and I think I tried to get this out on the panel. Jeff pitched us the teaser that you saw on screen. He literally pitched us that teaser in the room, and we're like, oh my God, that's, it was such great storytelling. And then he kind of laid out the show for us. But you know, like Gene said, like we're much more character driven. We've never done horror before. We've done some sci-fi, but you know, we approach this from as much of a character place as possible. And I think that's one of the things that made it feel different than, hopefully, than other things you've seen.
And when he pitched us that teaser, we wanted to know what happened to Agatha. How did the events of the show get to that point? And that's character success.
So I mean, obviously we've seen this first scene. So does the show then, is it basically all about flashbacks?
The scene you saw, we catch up to in episode 9.
So we show that right at the beginning of the show, and then we catch up, the show catches up to that point in episode 9.
And then from that point on, it's sort of like a sprint to the end. Like from, you know, 9 to the end of 10. The first season arc.
So in the tradition of George R.R. Martin shows, then episode 9 is the big deal.
Yeah, I guess that's right. You know, we weren't thinking about it that way, but it ended up.
Honestly, in the beginning, it was like episode 6, and then we had so much story, we just kept pushing it, and like, you know, it ended up being 9, but then that ended up being a perfect structure for the rest of the show.
So is it a standalone season?
It's built. The first season follows the arc of the novella, but we set up the end of the show so that it can go further. But we really follow the template that we laid out in the book. The book's only 100 pages, so you know it's not Game of Thrones where there's multiple books, hundreds and hundreds of pages. So it's basically a launching point.
Do you feel like that kind of gives you more freedom? Because I know there's always a balance between, you know, honoring the source material and doing something new. Do you feel like you have a little bit more freedom because there is only a short book?
Totally, yeah,
because we had to be true to the spirit of 100 pages. We didn't have to be true to a specific set of events.
Ten episodes. Yeah. We were just saying that the teaser happens in 9, and then we wrap the show in 10.
I know the novella is connected to the Thousand Worlds series that Martin's written. Are there any plans to connect any further, any of that work to
George it? Had the same question.
Okay.
I think the way Jeff has talked about it is that, you know, because obviously First Contact is sort of the premise of our show. The Thousand Worlds is not front and center at the beginning of our show.
Right.
It's possible that our show exists in that universe and that's where we sort of progress to. But we're sort of backing it up right there. Yeah.
In George, in the novella, there's already been alien contact and there's multiple, you know, alien species. And we thought it'd be more dramatic if it was the first contact and nobody's ever seen an alien species before.
Or our characters have it.
Our characters.
What kind of shows or movies do you think you drew from to kind of put this package together for the Sci-Fi Network?
Well, Jeff kind of mentioned a couple of touchstones. You know, Aliens is definitely a touchstone. 2001 is a touchstone.
Shining.
Yeah, I mean, part of the pitch was, you know, The Shining in space.
But as we went through it, you know, at different points in time, you know, people would say, oh, this seems like a little, I saw a little bit of this in Event Horizon, or actually as we talked about how grounded our version of this world was, Sunshine came to mind. So there are, you know, we've rubbed up against all of them, but hopefully we're defining our own world.
We didn't talk about this in the panel, but you know, the spaceship that we developed, we tapped into a lot of the feature film people we work with, and we used a production designer named Guy Hendricks, who designed the ship in Sunshine and in Passengers. And so we're always striving for features or quality visuals in this, not just on the lenses. But yeah, I think Guy's design really brought a lot of that sort of grounded sensibility that you see in Sunshine and, to this.
Three very large sound streams, full of spaceship.
They weren't literally airplane hangars, but it was a former Dell computer factory in Ireland.
We were building for 6 months. Sometime in the fall. They haven't been real specific yet, but
it was circling around October-ish.
So, with so many subcategories of horror out there, what kind of scares are fans going to be, you know, in store for with this show? How would you define it?
I mean, I think a lot of what you saw in the show, especially, you know, with Agatha and the Saw and Robin going after her, I mean, that's very emblematic of what the series is.
I mean, it's visceral, like you saw there. I'd say Jeff, the creator, was not necessarily. There are some jump scares in the show, but I wouldn't say it's a jump scare show. We tend to rely more on you feeling dread for a character. So it's
and psychological.
You mentioned somebody
dead. There's a lot of dead. Yes.
Well, that's George R. R. Martin.
Yeah.
We knew that, you know, doing this show, there'd be people from. Fans of Game of Thrones, we're going to expect that, and we felt like there was an obligation to deliver.
You know, we tried not to do it literally that way, because we tried to avoid the sort of red shirt, sort of Star Trek syndrome of, like, bringing up a crew member just for killing them off. So when we hurt characters or kill characters, we try to make them characters that we care invested in. Yes, I mean, we were limited by everybody had to be on the spaceship at the beginning of the show.
Yeah, we can arrive on the spaceship for that week.
Yeah.
Is that season two? People start arriving to the ship. You develop teleportation?
See? When you're dealing with alien life and the reveal of something that, like on a show like this, how do you go about when you make that reveal? Like, you don't want to do it too soon, but you don't want to do it too late.
Yeah.
How do you decide when the right time is?
Well, in this case, the novella was a guiding principle. The actual reveal of alien life happened at the end of the novella, and it happens at the end of, you know, the end of our first season.
But we're also believers in, like, less is more. You know, like Jaws, like, you know, once you've seen the shark, not so scary. It's
right. That's
so,
what I was trying to get.
Yeah, we very much honor that.
You know, and, you know, we talk about, like, a movie like that I love about, like, Signs. Great movie,
right.
Kind of until you see the alien, and then that's the end of the movie.
Yeah.
Swing away.